justice for all.
Hello?
So proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars shone through the perilous fight. For the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Thank you.
Am I going to read this or not? I'll leave it to you.
No, that's a board meeting. All right, good evening, everybody. And thanks for coming out tonight. Appreciate it. This is the Newmarket School District deliberative session for the year 2007-2008. And I'd like to start off with just some general information. Please, as a courtesy to those other voters and participants around you, I request at this time that you turn off your pagers and cell phones. Or if you have to, would you please turn them to a vibrate mode or a silent mode? And if you do have to have them on and you do have to receive a call or a page, would you please move to the back of the auditorium so as not to be a disturbance to everybody else? I do understand that some people may have a necessity to stay in touch. For your safety, I'd like to point out the emergency exits. There's two of them. There's to my left, your right, and on the opposite side also. And for your convenience, the restrooms are also on the other side of those doors. The ladies' room is on this side, and the men's room is to your right. Well, that clock is a little slow. It's now about, I'll call it 7:09, and I'd like to take this, I'd like to start this meeting. I'd also like to tell you that Jay Childs is here. He's over on my right here. He's an independent filmmaker out of Portsmouth, and he's filming a documentary on New Hampshire state town meetings and issues. And I guess he's been going around to other communities filming town meetings and such. So we welcomed him here tonight. Before I get into the Warren articles, I'd like to make a few announcements. My name's Bob Madej, and I'm your elected town moderator. My primary duties are to, first off, moderate this meeting, but also to oversee the school district voting that'll take place next month on March 13th. That's the second official town meeting. We used to do it all as one town meeting, and it's now under SB2, it's broken into two sessions, this being the first session and the actual votes being cast in the second session, which will take place on March 13th. So about this session, this is the first session, and You do have voting responsibilities in this session. It's your privilege as your privileges under the SB2 rules to have this town meeting, and you have the opportunity during this meeting to ask for and receive information on the warrant articles that the school board has presented to the town. Also at this time, you can ask questions on the warrant articles and feel free to make motions and cast any votes in any way on the warrant articles. Again, you can't change the nature of the warrant article, but you do have the opportunity to make changes to the warrant within the laws. May I also emphasize again that at this meeting, you guys are a voting body. Everyone here in this room, you can revise these warrants through standard meeting protocol of amendments, seconds, discussions, and tallied votes. And the second session, as I mentioned before, will be held on March 13th, where you will actually cast the vote on the warrant articles. This particular meeting, this deliberative session, and the voting session that follows is going to also be repeated for the town budget. So keep your eyes on the newspapers for the proceedings that'll go on for the town budget. I also want to emphasize to you that this is not the school board's meeting. This is not the budget committee's meeting. This is your meeting. This is a public meeting for the residents of New Hampshire. The warrant articles have been posted around town as a warrant to you, the residents of the town, on requests for funds. And in this first session, we'll be discussing those warrant articles. I also want to remind everybody that this is an official public meeting, and as such, everyone here has their own individual rights and responsibilities. During this meeting, everyone will be courteous to the speakers and those around them by remaining silent during the presentations. Please remain seated and attentive during the meeting. If you need to leave, please do so quietly, and if possible, please do so when there is no speaker speaking. Distributed is a handout of the moderator's rules. I would like to ask that everybody review these. Please share those with those next to you that might not have them. These are the rules that we're going to be following tonight in these proceedings. These rules are not new, and for most of the veteran voters here, they'll be familiar to them. A few of the rules I'd like to point out. First off, it's not written in the rules, but this is televised tonight, just for everybody's awareness. When asking a question or presenting your position, please use the microphone at the front here and start off with your first name and last name. Address all remarks and questions to myself, the moderator, and please limit your presentations to no more than 5 minutes. Non-registered voters may not participate in this meeting unless first approved by this body. And I'd like to ask at this time for those that are non-registered voters, if you are not already seated in the chained off area in the back of the room, please move there at this time. It's my responsibility to proceed over this meeting, your town meeting, and regulate its business, decide on the questions of order, and to make a public declaration of every vote passed. In this meeting, I will not tolerate destructive outbursts or unrecognized discussions. Individuals who are not courteous of others and who do not wish to follow the simple rules of the meeting conduct will be asked to leave this meeting. Since I cannot always hear what goes on in the audience, I would like to ask that if you find anything in this meeting to be distractive to you, from continuing with your business of this meeting, please bring it to my attention. Before we commence with the business at hand, does anybody have any questions on this meeting's progress and your individual rights, responsibilities?
Hello?
Good, we're all ready to go, right? At this time, I'd like to present to you the chairman of the school board and the budget committee, and they'll introduce the members of their boards. I'd like to start off with the school board chairman, Chris Hawkins.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Chris Hawkins, the chair of the school board. Starting on my far right is James Loisel, our student representative to the school board. Next to him is Sue Caswell, the business administrator of the district. Next is Kathy Murphy, the superintendent of schools. Next to her is Peter Bronstein, our attorney. The gentleman in the green shirt is Forrest Ransdell of the school board. The gentleman in the blue blazer is Paul Robinson. Immediately next to me is Cliff Chase, the vice chair of the school board.
Thank you, Chris. And for the budget committee, Rod Bowles.
Thank you. Thank you, Bob. First of all, I'd like to let you know that Richard Shelton has called and he's home not feeling well, and we all wish you good health, Richard. He's one of our members who's not here tonight. We have Mr. Chester Jablonski, Mr. Gary Jablonski. They are related, just in case you don't know. You have Bob Coffey, and then myself, Rod Bowles. The other members who are not able to be with us tonight are Brian Hart, William Harless, Keith Rieski, and our esteemed secretary and parliamentarian, Leo Fillion. And thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. Okay, as a matter of formalities, I'd just like to read the school warrant. To the inhabitants of the school district of Newmarket in the community of Rockingham, state of New Hampshire, qualified to vote in district affairs, you are hereby notified of the annual meeting. The first session for the transaction of all business other than voting by official ballot shall be held tonight, Tuesday, February 6, 2007 at 7 p.m. in the Newmarket Town Hall. The first session shall consist of explanation, discussion, debate for each warrant article. Warrant articles may be amended subject to the following limitations. Warrant articles whose wording is prescribed by law shall not be amended. Warrant articles that are amended shall be placed on the official ballot for final vote on the main motion as amended. The second session of the annual meeting to vote on questions required by law to be inserted on the said official ballot and to vote on all warrant articles from this, the first session on the official ballot shall be held Tuesday, March 13, 2007 at the Town Hall. Polls shall be open from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. Okay, one more time. Any questions from anybody on the format? Okay, what I'm going to do tonight is, let me see. I have something else here. You all have handouts, and there are other handouts out front here if you didn't pick them up. Of the warrants tonight, there's 11 warrants that we have to cover. And just in generalities, the first warrant asks for money to be obtained for architectural and engineering fees for the expansion of school facilities, basically a new high school. Warrant number two is to purchase portable classrooms. Warrant number three is to remove funds from various reserves to be used to purchase land. Warrant article number four is to approve the new teacher's contract. Warrant number five is to have a special town meeting if warrant article four does not pass. Warrant articles 6, 7, 8, 9, I'm going to group them all together, 6, 7, 8, 9, ask for the approval to fund various reserve funds from budget balances, if there are any, at the end of the year. Warrant article number 10 covers the school budget. And warrant article number 11 is a standard warrant article for other business. Now, with that being the summary, it's my duty to read the whole warrant article. So I'll try to do this as painlessly as possible. Warrant article number 1, to see if the school district will vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $1,297,200 for the purpose of architectural and engineering fees associated with the expansion of school facilities, and to authorize the issuance of not more than $1,279,200 of bonds or notes in accordance with the provisions of the Municipal Finance Act, and to authorize the school board to issue and negotiate such bonds or notes and to determine the rate of interest thereon. And furthermore, to authorize the school district to raise and appropriate an additional sum of $31,109 for the payment of the first year's interest on the bonds or notes authorized by this article. This article is recommended by the school board and budget committee. The 3/5 ballot vote required is for the second session, when we vote on it in the second session. And as another note, the expenditure of this article is contingent upon the purchase of land. So do I have a motion to put article number 1 on the floor?
Yes, Mr. Moderator, I'd like to make a motion to discuss article 1.
Thanks, Cliff. Do I have a second?
Second that, Mr. Moderator.
Thanks, Chris. And would the school board like to make a presentation on this?
Mr. Moderator, Paul Robinson is going to address this article on behalf of the school board. If I can also say briefly, Linda Montagani is not going to be with us tonight.
Hello, everyone. My name is Paul Robinson. I have about 7 PowerPoint slides, and I hope everybody can see that okay. Concerning Warren Article 1, and once I go through those, I'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have about it. As you can see, this is a breakdown of the different costs that are going to go into the architectural and engineering fees associated with this potential new high school for grades 9 through 12. There are a lot of numbers up there. I guess a couple of things I would highlight to you are that the best estimate on what this building would cost from the architect based on similar buildings that have been built recently in other towns is approximately $20.6 million. There's a standard 7% building and site cost per the AIA contract, and the costs of that 7% are broken down further there. I would note that part of that 7% is the cost of administering the building contract, which is approximately 20% of it, and that's $288,400. That is not included in the bond because at this point with this set of warrant articles, construction of an actual building is not a certainty. Next slide, please. Okay, some more numbers, smaller numbers. Basically having to do with additional services, as you can see, acoustical engineer and so forth. Again, with the deletion of the construction administration factor, totaling up to 37.6 there. And also other miscellaneous costs like the chimney modeling consultant and so forth. The estimated total fee comes out to at the bottom there, $1,279,200. That's an estimate, and you can see the note there at the bottom. The estimated fee is based on 7% of $20.6 million for building site and costs. Fee may be adjusted once the actual building and site costs are received. Next slide, please. Okay, what we'd like to show you on this slide is basically that our action in Warren Article 1 is an outgrowth of the recommendations of the Facilities Committee, which has met for the last year. What we're doing in seeking architectural and engineering costs at this point in time is separating those costs out from the actual vote on a building. The advantage that we feel that will come from this is that if in a year's time or at some point in the future, the board puts before the community a question of should we build a new high school, at that point we would know, by virtue of having gone through this design and permitting process, what the cost of that building would be with some degree of specificity. In other words, it would already be contracted, it would already be bid out, it would be contracted on, and we would have an idea of the exact cost.
It would be bid out but not contracted on.
Right, the contract would be signed after if it was approved by the voters. Thanks, Chris. Next slide, please. Okay, that was it. All right. On this slide, I think that beyond what I just said, I would just add that this bullet point, that the additional time provided by separation also allows for greater community input regarding specific design features, which would build on the work of the community task forces last fall. Next slide, please. Okay, here's the timeline. If this Warren article passes the vote, this is just to give you a sense of the progress of what would happen next. The design, the drawing and permits process would begin after the vote, after approval by the voters. We would go through the task forces process in a manner similar that we did the last time around. In other words, we would recruit a number of people who are involved with the building on a daily basis and could provide valuable input on the best and most efficient design for that building. That would all be fed directly back to the architect, who could then, as appropriate, incorporate those recommendations into the design. Then around Thanksgiving, end of November, beginning of December, the documents would go out to bid. They would be, the bids would be due. There would be a warrant early in 2008, about a year from now. If it passed, it would construction would begin shortly after that warrant article and run for approximately, I guess it goes into the summer of 2009. At which point move-in would be scheduled for sometime before the beginning of the school year in the fall of 2009. Next slide, please. Okay, this slide is simply a estimated debt schedule for this bond. The first year is interest only at $31,000, and the subsequent years, 9 through 13, are as indicated. Now, just wanted to point out here that at the bottom of the slide, the amounts will be offset by $76,740 in state building aid per year upon commencement of the project. The sums in this bond would be compensated, reimbursed, by the state at a rate of 30% if we do build the building. So that's what that note is indicating. So we can move to questions now, if anybody has any questions about the Warren Article 1. Okay.
Thanks. Yep. Thanks, Paul. Okay. I know, once again, it's any questions on the warrant. This is your meeting to step up and ask. So, and I'd like to please ask that you come up to the microphone, please, because we are televised and recorded. So,
Mr. Moderator, my name is Debbie Hale, 231.
Could you
closer?
Pull it? Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Maybe bend it down a tad.
There you go. How's that?
There you go.
Mr. Moderator, my name is Debbie Hale. I live at 231 South Main Street. I would like to move that Article 1 be amended as follows, that after the expansion of school facilities, insert the phrase, only on land purchased by the district or town by agreement with any selling landowner, unquote, and then continue with the comma and the rest of the article as written. This allows the board to use the funds they desire on a project where they have obtained the land by agreement with the owner, so that funds are not wasted on a design for land that the board would like to have but does not have under agreement.
Okay. Debbie, do you have that in writing?
Yes,
with
I
you
do.
There?
Would
May
you
I
like
have that?
That?
That's helpful for me. Thank you. Okay, so we have a motion on the floor, and I'll read it one more time. To insert after the expansion of school facilities the phrase, only on land purchased by the district or town by agreement with any selling landowner. And then continue with the rest of the article. So that's our motion on the floor. Do we have a second for this motion? And who would that be? Colleen. Colleen Bertagnoli. Thank you, Colleen. Okay, we have a motion and a second on the floor. Do we have any discussion? Anybody have any questions on the motion?
Mr. Moderator.
Yes.
We would like to get the opinion of our council on whether that motion is within the spirit of Warren Article 1. Can we have him speak on that?
Certainly.
Thank you.
Subject matter.
Forrest, can you lend him your microphone?
Here you go.
Does it reach?
It doesn't reach.
Forrest, do you want to switch seats with him? Peter, temporarily, so you can use a mic. So people can hear. Thank you, Forrest.
The subject matter of Article 1 is to provide funds for architectural and engineering fees associated with the expansion of school facilities. My opinion that the subject matter in the amendment goes far beyond the subject matter that people have been warned would be in Article 1, so it should not be considered.
Okay. For those who didn't hear that, I'll just reiterate it again. As stated, was that the motion as put before you and seconded deals with the purchase of land, whereas the warrant article is specific to architectural and engineering fees for development of school facilities, not purchase of land. And it is his opinion that it is not applicable to this warrant article, and I think I would agree with him on that. Certainly. Debbie, come on back up.
Mr. Moderator, I would respectfully request that my attorney be allowed to speak. He's not a resident of town, but he has a differing opinion with Mr. Bronstein. Again, I know every attorney has a different opinion, and I would appreciate his being able to express that on my behalf.
Okay, your attorney is not a resident of the town?
No, he is not.
Okay. As far as normal proceedings, normal town meetings go, and by the statutes of the RSAs, these town meetings are for residents of the town only. Now, there are provisions to allow for non-residents to speak at this meeting, and they're to be approved by myself, the moderator. Thank you for addressing me. Then I will default to the public in the room. This is your meeting, and I would like to ask you by a show of hands if you would like to have a non-resident speak at your meeting. So first off, those in favor of allowing this individual to speak, please raise your hand. Can I get a helping hand in counting? Please keep them up.
Thank you.
And we got one over here. Okay, 31, 32. And those opposed, please raise your hand. Yeah, I got about 9. Okay, so it's in favor to allow your attorney to speak.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Again, I'd like to just ask, limit the discussion to 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator, and members of the public boards. Very briefly, my name is Chris Bolt. I am representing Mike Wheat and Deb Hale. With all due respect to Peter, I believe the amendment as proposed is within the scope of the warrant that you are currently considering. I ask you to note specifically that the warrant as proposed includes the last clause that this expenditure is expressly contingent upon the purchase of land. It is merely a clarification of where you are desiring to use these architectural funds, and that we are wanting the public, if they are to support this article, to clearly show that they are supporting an article on land that this community is actually buying rather than the threatened taking that has been so much a topic of discussion. So that is the purpose of the amendment for clarification. It is not beyond the scope of the article itself, nor is it beyond anything that has been warned with this warrant. Thank you very much for your consideration. I'm happy to answer any question.
Thank you, Chris. Okay, I'd like to once again point out to you folks that the part of the warrant that Mr. Bolt pointed to is a note on the warrant. It's not the actual warrant itself. It's just a comment, and it says that last sentence of the warrant article is just a comment phrase. There is another warrant article that we'll be voting on tonight that discusses taking funds out of reserve funds for the specific purchase of land. And it is my personal opinion, and I think it's also of the attorney over here, that may be the most appropriate place to have this discussion, because this warrant article is specifically talking about architectural and engineering fees. Yes.
Bob, can I be recognized? Bill Connor. First of all, I'd like to compliment you on your job as moderator. You've done a superb job last year, and you're doing a good job this year.
Thank you.
I'd like to propose an amendment to this article.
Bill, I'm going to have to cut you short there. We're only going to take one amendment at a time on the floor.
Well, we're not done with the first one?
We'll have to vote it down first before we take a change to it. Thank you. I'm sorry, Chris wants to have a...
He means vote it.
I'm sorry, yeah,
vote it. You guys are going to vote, he's not going to vote.
Yeah, go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, Mr. Moderator, I want to speak to the amendment. I want to speak to the amendment briefly. Not as to the legality or illegality of it, that's for other people to decide. I just want to point out a couple of things. First of all, while the school district certainly hasn't ruled out the possibility of utilizing eminent domain to acquire property necessary to accomplish school expansion purposes, we have not yet invoked the necessity to do that. It's not immediately apparent. Certainly a lot has been said, but we haven't invoked the authority yet. So the question, while it has certainly come up in discussion, isn't exactly in play in the legal sense at this time. We have also heard a fair amount of comment at the budget session and elsewhere. Certainly I've gotten a few phone calls at home expressing concern about the price that the school district has proposed. The price is based on an appraisal that we received. The appraisal is based upon certain assumptions. We asked the appraiser to go back and re-examine those assumptions because we were very concerned that we do what we can consistent with our obligations to the school district to treat people fairly. Today, we received an updated number from the appraiser. It is a higher number. I don't want to get into the specifics of it because I don't think we've yet had an opportunity to share it with Ms. Hale and Mr. Wiatt, and I think it's only fair that they hear it first. So to the extent that that plays a part in anybody's thinking, it may or it may not, but if I don't tell you, then obviously it can't. But I do want people to at least hear that in case it makes a difference to the way you think. Thank you, Bob.
Okay, thanks, Chris. There was a gentleman that also wanted to make a comment, I believe. Yes, please step up if you want. Anybody else who wants to talk on this, feel free to just stand up into the aisle and we'll try to just get this meeting to go, you know, one by one right on through.
Lynn Badger, and is that all I say?
Yes, that's fine, Lynn. Okay. Thanks.
I'm just a tiny bit confused, but in my mind, it sort of seems if we're giving money for a plan, that we should have a clue where the plan is going to go. And if we don't, then in my mind, I hate to be voting for giving money on a plan that's going who knows where, as we already have a plan that we didn't use. So it seems that we can be using plan after plan on piece of land after piece of land and never have a school. That's all.
Thanks, Lynn. Anybody care to address that?
If I may, Mr. Moderator, Chris. Thank you. We do have a plan. The plan is laid out on those boards. The plan as proposed calls for building a high school facility on property currently owned by Mr. Wiatt and Ms. Hale, and calls for building what I'll call athletic portions of the facility on land owned by the Carpenters greenhouse property. So that is the plan as it stands today.
Thanks, Chris. Sure, please just line up, you know, in the aisle, and we'll try to move things along.
Jim Fitzpatrick. So to follow up on Lynn's question, so if I understand this warrant correctly, we're fronting 7% of the of an estimated building cost for plans on land we do not yet have pending votes and warrants and agreements. Is that true?
That is, well, actually, that's not completely true. The expenditure of the funds is contingent on acquisition of the land. So, I mean, we're not going to expend the funds acquiring the land.
Which land?
The specific land under discussion, the land owned by the Wiatts and Hale.
Okay, so if we were to pass warrant one, mm-hmm. then that 7% would be applied to that particular piece of property's development.
No, that it would not go to this particular warrant article does not address the question of purchasing.
Well, that was the question I asked. If it's 7% against a plan, and I was just told that the plan we have is aimed at a specific piece of property, then it would seem that this money would go for this property or not.
Okay, I'll address that.
Okay.
Yes. Yes, the I know it may be a little confusing, but the first warrant article is purely to have the town vote and approve the expenditure of monies for architectural and engineering fees. The actual purchase of the land is another warrant article that we'll be discussing later in the evening. It's divided into two separate warrant articles. I guess the school board decided to do that, or maybe it's by law. Maybe not, but you do have the choice here to approve the engineering and architectural fees in this article, but maybe not approve the purchase of land in another. But it is broken into two different warrant articles.
If I may, Mr. Moderator, I'd like to address that issue because I think that is a confusing piece of this. Please keep in mind that none of the warrant articles tonight address the purchase of any specific property. There are certainly pieces of property under consideration, but these warrant articles do not seek money for the purchase of a specific property. They give the school district the option to end, you know, to complete negotiations for the purchase of property, There certainly are two pieces of property that are currently under strong consideration. I make no bones about that, but they're not directed at, you know, permission to purchase property X, as in, because there's not a purchase and sales agreement in place on any property. It allows the school district to continue its negotiations and to work forward in good faith, knowing what kind of limits and available funds the community would be have us use. On the second piece, the A&E on Article Number 1, it would not, again, be appropriated for any particular property. It would be appropriated for whichever property came to fruition where we would look to build a senior high school only. So again, it's not directly tied to a particular piece of property.
And if Thank I you. Could just add to that briefly, Article 1 calls for the issuance of bonds. Article 3 does not. It's another reason it would be very, I'm not sure you could possibly fit those things together, even if you tried, for that simple reason.
Okay. Sorry. Jonathan.
Jonathan Sheff, 200 South Main Street, Newmarket. I would just like some clarification, Mr. Moderator, on the issue of what we're doing here tonight. We are placing these articles on the ballot for the voters to make a decision. We're not making a decision tonight about purchasing anything or spending any money. We are just making decisions tonight about what the voters will get to vote on. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. Yeah, tonight we're going to finalize the warrants in front of you, and they will then appear on the ballot next month on the 13th. And I think we have a question up here.
Just a quick observation from our discussions in the various budget meetings. My understanding, just, and hopefully this clarifies it maybe a little bit more, is that the land purchase, whatever land that might be, for getting a plan in place so we can vote on a new school, this would authorize the school board to issue a bond to start that process. But the process of the architectural and engineering plans will not take place until land has been purchased. That's my understanding. So all we're really doing here is authorizing the school board the opportunity to go out and get a bond if land is purchased. Okay. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
Before you get started, maybe I need to make a little clarification at this time. The motion on the floor is to amend the article to read only land purchased by the district or town by agreement with a selling landowner. That's the motion on the floor that we should be discussing. Thank you. If anybody, I'm going to ask for comments specific to the motion to insert the phrase into the warrant, and please limit your discussions to that motion. Thank you. Okay.
I think my comments are kind of to that. My name is Amy Rossi. And my concern about starting to insert additional things into these warrant articles is that things are getting more and more confusing. What we really need to do right now is to find a way to get started in this process. I personally have a 6th and 7th grader in this town, and I would love to see them end up in another school. I myself went to DC Public Schools, and those of you that don't know anything about those, we were pretty sad about where we went to school. And I have to tell you, it's looking pretty good right now compared to our junior senior high. So I would like us to be able to move along with these warrant articles and let the voters vote so that we can possibly have a new school in our town before 2010, because that's what we're looking at right now. And if we start getting a lot of other things mixed into these warrant articles, it's not going to happen. Thank you.
Thanks, Amy.
Todd Roger. I'm not speaking for or against the article, but I am concerned about the amendment. I don't like the idea of this small group of people tonight making a decision like that. I really think this decision ought to be put in front of the voters of the town. I think the amendment just muddies the water and ties our hands for future possible action.
Thank you, Todd. Yes, Bill.
Every boarder in town has had the opportunity to come here tonight. They just chose not to.
Thank you. That's correct. Okay. Any more questions on the amendment? Okay. Seeing none, then I'm going to ask for a vote on the amendment, not on the article. This is on the amendment only. And once again, the amendment is to insert a phrase into the warrant that says only on land purchased by the district or town by agreement with the selling landowner. Okay, at this time, I'd like to see a show of hands for those in favor of the amendment. Can I get some help with the count now? Thank you. And those opposed to the amendment? Yeah, I see more than 22. Okay, so the amendment does not pass. So we're back to the warrant article as written and as presented in the paperwork in front of you. Any questions? Any questions on the warrant article in front of you? Okay, yes, go ahead, Bill.
Mr. Moderator, I'd like to make a motion. And that is to have the Article 1 read, appropriate the sum of $0 for the purpose of architectural and engineering fees. If you'd like that in writing, you can.
I think I've got it, Bill. Thank you. Okay, do we have a second for the motion as presented? Thank you, Ellie. Ellie Connor, second that. Any discussion on the amendment on the floor at this time? The amendment on the floor is to revise the dollar amount of the warrant to zero money. And although that may seem odd, it would go on the ballot that way with the wording as it currently reads and a $0 amount. And that is permissible. As you know, you can't buy the funding for $0. And that's what this body can so do if you do desire. Okay. Any questions? I don't see any. Okay. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Russ Simon. I'm not sure this is an appropriate question, but since we've voted before on a school, I didn't know how much had already been spent on designs for schools that haven't been done in Newmarket in the past several years. How much architectural and engineering work has been done on what hasn't passed?
Okay, so if I understand your question correctly, Russ, you're asking how much architectural engineering fees have already been expended to date on facilities designs. Okay, can I get somebody to discuss that? Even in a roundabout way, maybe not an exact dollar amount, but.
We haven't spent any money on a design for new high school because this warrant article asks us for permission to do that.
I understand that, but I don't think that's the question. The question is, I think you're relating to last year when we were discussing a new school last year.
That, and also I was at a school board facilities committee meeting where there was an engineer who was showing plans and talking about designs for the school already that hadn't even been approved but was just a thought. So apparently we've hired consultants and engineers to put designs together before we've even voted to put money on. I'm assuming that was both for this set of properties as well as the previous properties at the golf club. And so my question again is, how much have we spent in the last 3 years on engineers and architects to date on something that still hasn't been approved?
Okay. Does everybody understand the question? It appears that there's been some upfront work already done on some design work, and how much was spent on that?
Unfortunately, the answer remains the same. We haven't spent any money on design work. I know you saw pictures of what it could look like. What we did spend money on last year was a study to examine the facility. We did a study with Team Design who reviewed our programs and facilities. That study was approximately $40,000. Also last year, we had to do some due diligence, as you know, on pieces of property. And we had to decide whether that property was suitable enough for a school building, to house a school building. So in fact, we had to do some wetlands mapping. We did some environmental testing on properties. And we did some surveying to make sure that the information we had, so we probably spent in total $35,000. So to date, if you want to put those two together, we've spent about $75,000 on study and our due diligence to determine what an appropriate piece of property would be.
Excuse me again, I'm sorry. I saw plans for a high school at the facilities meeting. And there was someone there who was hired by the school board who said he has a 92% chance of success if you hired him. He'd already been hired. If I'm not using the right words, please correct me. If it's design, that's the word you're speaking to, and all other fees related to consultants and engineering and architecture is what I'm asking.
The plans you saw last year were concepts. They were ideas that the architect presented to the school board for their review and approval. That was part of the $35,000 that we spent last year for due diligence. I mean, we had to bring forward to the community something for you to look at, so that was part of the $35,000.
Okay, so $75,000 or so is what's been spent today. Thank you.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor to amend warrant article 1 to $0. Any questions on the amendment? Okay, thank you for that. I'd like to move this to a vote. Please raise your hands for those in favor of amending warrant article number 1 to $0. Okay, I got 15. Yep. Okay, and those opposed, please raise your hand. I'm done. I don't need to count. Okay. So it does not pass. We're back now to the warrant article as written.
Move the article, please.
Okay. Greg Thayer is asked to move the article to vote, and that's not debatable. So we'll take a vote on warrant article number 1. Those in favor of warrant article 1 as written and presented in front of you, please raise your hands. And actually, I don't even know why I'm taking this vote, because there's not an amendment on the floor. You see, so we got 28, and that's what I got. So, I mean, if nobody presents an amendment to the warrant right now, there's no change to it, and it will go as written on the ballot. I tried to emphasize this at the town meeting the other day. So, for those of you that might be opposed to the wording, if you don't step up at this time, as I said, this is your meeting. If you don't step up and make an amendment to the warrant article, it just we just move on to the next warrant article. So that's why I said it's kind of a mute point to ask for a yes-no vote at this point.
I'm sorry, what did we just vote on then? I'm
confused. We didn't need to pass a vote. There's really no motion on the floor.
Okay.
So, okay, we're going to conclude warrant article number 1 and move to warrant article number 2. Warrant article number 2, to see if the school district will vote to authorize the school board to enter into a long-term lease purchase agreement in the amount of $210,925 payable over a term of 36 months at a rate of $6,349 per month to purchase portable classrooms
and appropriate the sum of $76,188 for the first year's payment for that purpose, including the setup of the units. This is recommended by the school board and the budget committee, and when we vote on it next month, a 3/5 ballot vote is required. Do I have a motion to put article number 2 on the floor?
I would like to make that motion, Mr. Moderator. Okay.
Thank you, Chris. And a second?
I'd like to second that.
Okay, thank you,
Mr. Moderator.
Okay, does the school board like to make a presentation for this?
Yes, I would, Ms. Moderator.
All right, Forrest, thanks.
Mr. Moderator, thank you. Mr. Chairman, and Mr. Chairman, thank you. Good evening. My name is Forrest Rensdell. I'm a member of the school board. I've been appointed for to fill out the recently vacated term by Mr. Jablonski, and appreciate that opportunity. And I'm here to explain to you tonight the purpose behind article number 2. The first piece of data that I'd like you to consider is that while we are, as a school board and as a school district, working on a long-term plan to meet the educational needs of our students and your children, we have developed over the last 20 or 25 years some very, very immediate needs that should be addressed in the short term as well. And in looking to address the short-term crowding conditions at the middle high school, we put forth to you article number two, which asks for the lease purchase of 2 portable buildings. I'd like to point out that we are not looking to deal with projected enrollment growths, and I know that that is, you know, it's very easy and very convenient sometimes to look at those projections. We are looking to meet current needs that have developed over the last 20 years. The projected growth is already here. We're living it. It's not coming. The enrollment increases that have taken place over the last 25 to 30 years have come with no increased footprint at the junior senior high school. The building footprint, the building plan is the same as has been for many years. Newmarket, the junior senior high school has not had an increase in the footprint since 1965. And in 1965, there were 261 students at school within that building. While in 1987, when the Cross Gym was built, through community graces, 2 classrooms were able to be added to the from the old gym space. But again, that didn't increase the overall footprint. It did provide, you know, 2 additional classrooms. At that time, there were 356 students in the building. In 1998, the building underwent renovations to upgrade entrances and some aging infrastructure issues, and the student population was 550. Currently, the building houses 617 students, and we have not added a square foot of instructional space since the Melvin Cross Gym was built in 1987, where we added 2 classrooms. So we're dealing with current space crunch issues and have been there for a number of years. And those issues then, you know, domino into other issues as crowded hallways and all of those kinds of things that we'd rather our kids probably not deal with. Currently, there are 9 classes operating without dedicated classroom space. Many of those classes then are taking place in spaces that were not designed for instruction. Some of them are closets and small offices in some cases. That would be a few, but nonetheless, that does happen. That's 25% of the instructional staff, almost 24 point a fraction, that doesn't have a classroom to call home at our junior senior high school. Labs, arts, things that are on carts and moving around that require our kids to put hands-on learning. Teachers are moving carts around from classroom to classroom rather than setting up and doing, you know, what they need to do in a place where they can really build that curriculum really well. At this point, if I could ask James to put up, and I'll try to move to the side a bit. I do tend to make a better wall than a window. And if I hope that I'm speaking loud enough so that the mic can still pick up. This would be the configuration of 1 of the portable buildings. We're asking for 2 this year, again, to meet these short-term needs. Each building provides us with 2 classrooms. Okay, I'm being told that I can't be heard. So now that you've seen it, I'll come back. Each building provides us with two classrooms. It would give us a total of four additional classrooms. Certainly would not alleviate that need for nine additional classroom spaces, but would allow for the redistribution of resources so that departments then could work together and be more efficient in what they do, at least to a certain degree. Is there another slide with the location, James? I don't think there's another slide. The proposed location for these is what is, I believe, known as the senior parking lot, if you will. Oh, if you're on the front entrances from the cross gym, that parking lot that's out satellited just a little bit out there to the right side, if you're looking in from Carpenter's property across the street. It's level, has access to the appropriate things that are needed to put these in place. With the increased enrollment, the building administration has been forced to hold programs for students in unsuitable spaces, as I've said. And finally, while I know that this is a, you know, it is a tax impact article, we project that the tax impact will be 11 cents for this article. We believe that it is a prudent and fiscally responsible way to address immediate needs as we as a community work to increase, you know, our educational capacities with long-term plans. Finally, I'd like to thank the school board and the budget committee for both considering this and recommending it to the voters. And we did intentionally make places as a separate warrant article so that the community could see the short-term and the immediate needs juxtaposed against our longer-term goals, and also so that we have an honest accounting and an open accounting of what's needed now, and it's not just within the budget, and it's one more thing to sort of tick off in there as a budget increase. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Forrest. Okay, so with respect to warrant article number two, is everybody satisfied with the wording, the funding, as it's written?
You want a motion and a second first, Bob?
I have a motion and a second to put it on the floor for discussion.
Sorry.
Yes.
Just had a question on the funding, if I could.
I just wanted to understand that if in Article 3, which I know we haven't discussed yet, there's $1.6 million of reserves that we're being asked to approve to be used to purchase land. If the buildings for the extra classrooms are that important, why wouldn't we be using that money as a first priority, if that's available?
Thank you for the question. I think that's a good question. We did discuss that. And again, it's that comparison between those short-term immediate needs and the long-term goals. And the board, you know, in consultation with the budget committee, didn't feel that it was prudent to expend your savings account for something that is only a partial temporary short-term solution. We should really be using that reserve funds to further our long-term goals and long-term needs for our community. And I think that's the logic behind the decision.
Any other questions, comments, or concerns on warrant article number two? Seeing none, then warrant article number two stands as written and will be moved to the ballot next month. Moving on to warrant article number three. Put my specs on here. To see if the school district will vote to raise and appropriate the sum not to exceed $1,650,000 for the purpose of purchasing land and authorize the withdrawal of up to $1 million from the Capital Reserve Fund created for that purpose, with the balance of $450,000 to be funded through open space funds and $200,000 from impact fees. This is recommended by the school board and the budget committee. Majority of vote is required. And as another note, this article will have no tax impact because it's coming from reserve funds that have already been set up for this purpose. But it's presented to the voters here because the voters do have to approve the appropriation of funds from any capital reserve funds to be spent. As we started discussing on the first warrant article, this is your authorizing the withdrawal of funds for the purchase of land. Any questions or comments on warrant article number three? Wait a minute, I'm sorry, and I'll hold you for just a moment. Do I have a motion to put warrant article number three on the floor?
Mr. Moderator, I'd like to make a motion to put warrant article three on the floor.
Thanks, Paul. And do I have a second? Okay, and I have a second from Greg Thayer. I think you beat others to it. Okay, and would the school board like to make a presentation on warrant article number 3?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, Chris.
The purpose of this article is simply to give us, and again, this was developed, the amount was developed in consultation with the budget committee. We followed their recommendation that we simply put the maximum amount of money potentially available to us on the warrant so that we have some flexibility in negotiations with landowners or in property acquisition otherwise. We have $1 million, give or take a few thousand, in our currently existing capital expansion fund. We do not have the authority, the school board does not have the authority to expend those funds without the permission of the voters. There's $450,000 in the open space fund account that is that the town council has been authorized to expend. You may recall, I think it was in 2002 when that warrant article was passed, there was a parenthetical at the end of it that said the money was intended to be, the purpose of it was to be expended for open space, recreational, and school district purposes. And we have $200,000 currently available to us through impact fees. We're not saying that this is the maximum amount of money that will be required. We're not saying that we're going to spend every dime of this. We simply are looking for the maximum flexibility that we can have without impacting the tax rate. If it turns out that an additional appropriation is necessary to finalize the acquisition of property, we'll bring that back next year on the warrant for folks to vote up or down. But that is the intent, the simple intent behind this warrant article. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Connor, you had questions still?
Mr. Moderator, try once again. I'd like to make a motion to zero the dollar amounts out in this article, this warrant article.
Thank you. And is there a second to move the warrant article to a $0 amount? Ellie Connor, thank you. Any discussion on changing the wording of the warrant article to $0, please? None. Hearing none, I'd like to take it right to vote. All those in favor of changing the warrant article to $0, please raise your hand. That's what I got. And those opposed, please. Okay, all right, the nays have it. Any other discussion, comments, questions on warrant article number 3?
Expecting me, Mr. Moderator?
Yes, that's fine. Go ahead.
Mr. Moderator, I would like to move that we amend article 3 as follows. After, quote, for the purpose of purchasing land, unquote, insert the phrase, only by written agreement with any selling landowner, then continue with and in the rest of the article as written. And I would like to say, point out that this authorizes the use of this considerable amount of funding to buy land by agreement, but not to take anyone's land by eminent domain. Thank you.
I hope I get this right. Okay, the motion on the floor is to revise warrant article number 3 as follows. After the words, for the purpose of purchasing land, insert the phrase, only by written agreement with any selling landowner. And then continue with an and then the rest of the article is written. Do I have a second for the motion that's on the floor? Second by Colleen. Again, I think you did the other one too. Okay, I have a motion and second for an amendment to warrant article number 3. And again, the amendment is to insert the phrase only by written agreement with any selling landowner. So I'd like to open the floor for discussions on the amendment only, please. Questions, comments, or discussion on the amendment?
I hope you agree with me, Mr. Moderator, that this does indeed pertain to the amendment. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Debbie Hale, and I would like to tell you our story. In 1985, I married Mike Wyatt, and like many couples, we bought a house. But we didn't buy just any house. It was the house that Mike's grandparents had owned, the house that his mother grew up in, the house where he spent his childhood. Family heritage was, and still is, very important to both of us. We consider ourselves fortunate that we have been able to keep the remainder of the original Sopel family farm together, as our children are the fourth generation to grow up here. We have always intended to spend the rest of our lives here, working on the house and the land, looking forward to retirement, where we would have plenty of time to putter and enjoy our property. Over the years, we've received many calls from the town, the rec department, the school district, real estate developers, all asking if we would be interested in selling our property. Everyone, including Mr. Hawkins, who asked several years ago, received the same answer: no. We want to keep the property together, in the family, and undeveloped. So the years go by, we're living our lives, minding our own business, when we receive a letter from Superintendent Murphy asking us to call her if we were interested in selling our land. We weren't, so we didn't call. However, letters and calls kept coming. And then to our surprise, we learned that Doucette Survey had drawn up plans showing a new school on our property. Property that the school didn't own, property that the town didn't own, property where the owners, us, have repeated for years that we do not want to sell. And those plans were completed before the district even asked if they could have this property surveyed to, quote, verify the land mapping was accurate in order to determine if the school district was really interested in the property. Think about it. How would you feel if you suddenly found out that town officials had decided to take over your property and build a school on it without your knowledge or your consent? And then they all wonder why we're upset. We felt like we had been kicked in the stomach. We have been physically ill every day for the past 2 months. And we have had to hire an attorney to protect us and our rights from the town that has been home to four generations of this family. Contrary to Mr. Hawkins' statements of last week, this is our home. If the town takes our property, they are taking our home. We cannot live on a house lot with our horses, nor do we want to. We are here because of the land, because of the family farm. Just think, everyone, please. If they can try to take our property, who will be next? Because it could be any one of you. Please remember our family motto, save our family home and heritage, four generations, and we will never give up. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Debbie.
Mr. Moderator, may I address the meeting?
Certainly.
Thank you. I've said before, and I'll say again, that the possibility of eminent domain is not something that the school district takes lightly. We do not question in any respect, and never have and never will, that the Wyatts are upset. We certainly sympathize with their feelings. We don't diminish their concerns in any way, shape, or form. And I don't want anyone to leave here with that thought in their mind. I will respectfully suggest passing the amendment as proposed is basically the equivalent of just zeroing out the article. It's not our money. It's not the five members of the school district, five members of the school board taking a decision that they've decided to take a piece of property for no good reason at all. It is part of our responsibility to bring to the district's attention issues that are a vital concern. Why this piece of property in particular? If you take a look at the maps and drawings that are over there, you will see that the property we're speaking about intervenes between the existing land rock field and the elementary school facility. It gives us a unique opportunity to create a school campus environment for all of our school facilities, keeping them close to the center of town, really ameliorating the concerns about transportation safety that were very much to the fore in last year's meeting. So it satisfies a great many concerns that we think are responsive to the concerns expressed by the voters during last year's process. It is not our money, it is your money. Saying that the only way we can acquire property by agreement, which is, I suppose, within your discretion, is the equivalent. If despite that you think this is still a good plan, you're essentially saying that to the landowners that they can demand any price they want, which is why I say it is the equivalent of zeroing out the article, because it makes the entire process impossible to move forward as a practical matter. The right to exercise eminent domain does not belong to the school board. It is something that we exercise on your behalf as for the good of the school district as a whole as we see it. So we think that from our point of view, from the district's point of view, the way to evaluate this is to say, is this plan good for the school district, good for the future of the school district or not? We don't know at this point exactly whether eminent domain is going to be necessary. It may be, it may not be. We have not yet made that determination. But if you think this is a good plan, we think that you shouldn't tie your own hands by taking the possibility of eminent domain, which is your statutory right, off the table. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Any other questions or concerns on the warrant article? You might have to pull that down a little bit.
Linda Chris. Everybody keeps kind of pussyfooting around eminent domain. We don't know whether we're going to take it by eminent domain. If you get that land, why don't you just say it? You're going to have to take it by eminent domain. They've said, I don't know how much more clearly they could say, they don't want to sell. So why all this pussyfooting's going around, I don't know. Everything seems to be clouded. And I don't know what the reason is. I don't know. I don't understand it. This seems like this. Very confusing. This seems like this. This is very confusing. It seems like now's the time we should clear things up.
Okay.
May I respond?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead. I just thought it was a statement, but that's okay.
No, to the extent that there's unclarity, I certainly want to clear it up. The reason why I say I don't know whether we will or we won't is because, with all due respect, we just got today a new number. And we think it's fair to put that number on the table. I understand what's been said. I understand perfectly well what's been said, that they'll never give up, et cetera, et cetera. That may well be the case. If this plan is approved, if Article 1 passes, if Article 3 passes by the voters, we will take the steps that are necessary to acquire this property. We will not take those steps until we put a fair offer on the table based on the appraised number that we have today. It may or may not make a difference, but we think it's our obligation to be as fair as we can in this process. I hope that's clear. Sure.
I'm Trish Simon.
Trish, can you please come up to the microphone?
I'm coughing my way up here. I'm trying to understand. You just said we will make an offer, and if that offer is not accepted, it'll be a fair offer. If that offer is not accepted, we will do what it takes to get that land. Is that what I just heard you say?
If Article 1 passes and Article 3 passes, then we will take the steps that are necessary to acquire the property, because we think that the voters would have said that the plan as we proposed it is a good plan.
I'm sorry, Linda. I'm going to ask you to just hold off for a moment. You may get another chance to speak, but there is other individuals that want to talk. Yes, Sean.
Hi. Rich Alperin, 204 South Main. It's a shame that this is as tears people apart the way it's doing it, but I just want everybody to keep one thing in mind of, don't ask me who, but somewhere in history, a famous philosopher said, the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few. People need to think about that.
Hello, Mr. Moderator. My name is Karen Turner. I think it's unfortunate that we're in this situation as a community. I'm personally aware of the work that's been done by many over the past few years to identify land by other means. I just want to make sure that this whole conversation is grounded in the reality of what the children in the community are experiencing in terms of really inadequate educational facilities and really unsafe educational facilities. And I don't know the landowners. I'm not privy. I haven't been able to. It is hard for a lot of people to come to these kinds of things for lots of reasons. I tend to think maybe somebody would change their mind, but I doubt, based on the passion of the person speaking, that it would be based on the financial amount, but perhaps it would be based on a sense of the community need of the generations of children, including in that family, that deserve to have an appropriate and adequate education. And I'm reflecting on the fact that we're having to vote as a community on modulars. We're having to vote on spend money now on modulars because we don't have an adequate facility. And those are only going to last so long. And so it's clear we're in this predicament and something has to be done long term. And those are my comments. Thank you.
Good evening, sir. James Tremblay, Technology Director for the School Department. I'm a little confused here. As I read the articles, I did not see any reference to any specific piece of property, just the freeing up of money that existed in the coffers to go ahead and make purchase and sales arrangements. Is that correct?
That is correct. The warrant article, as written, does not direct to a specific parcel.
So our deliberations over heritage and whatnot are irrelevant at this point?
In a way. However, the proposal, the intent of the school board, and the plans that are on the easel surround the room relate to a specific parcel.
But there's still plans for the voters to vote on. We're here tonight to present the opportunity to the rest of the town folks to be able to choose whether or not this plan is something they want.
It is the intent of the school board to direct the funds from this warrant article to a particular parcel as being discussed.
Okay. Just curious on that matter. Thank you, sir.
If unless I'm wrong, and I've been known to be wrong.
Not by me.
Ed Polishano. I guess the one question I have is, you have carpenters who, from what you're saying, is willing to sell. It's going to come down to a price. Wheats doesn't want to sell. What is the problem with, I believe they have 15 acres across the street, and the town has an additional, I think, 5 acres that abuts that property. Why can't the school be there, buy the lands from the Landrock Field from the town, the money you're going to put into paying the Wheats if they wanted to sell, renovate the fields, fix them up to standards, and leave them alone? Problem solved. You probably saved money.
Before you step down, Ed, I just want to get a clarification. You had asked about the Carpenter property, and then you had talked about Landrock Field.
Right. We have fields.
Do you have two questions then?
You're looking to purchase two pieces of property to build new fields and a high school. We have fields. We just don't want to sell. Carpenters has land they want to sell. 15 acres plus what the town owns. Put them together, build your school. I believe the school sits on 4 acres right now, 5 acres. You have fields. Put the money, allocate the money you were going to give to the Weirds and spend building new fields. Fix what you got. You already buy it from the town. If it costs $100,000, buy the fields from the town, fix them. Make them up to standards.
Okay. I think you have a question then on...
It's a point.
Just a point? Okay, that's fine.
I mean, it's leave the people alone and use what you have. Put the money into it. Fix it. People want to sell. Go that avenue. Leave them alone. It's not your land. It's their land.
Okay, thanks, Ed. I guess I personally want to elaborate on that a little, and that is... Can somebody discuss the Landrock Field and what that is and who owns it and its purpose? It's already locked up, is it not?
A couple things, Bob. Before we looked at the Wiat property, we looked at putting the facility on the Carpenter property. The Carpenter property is, unfortunately, significantly constrained by wetlands, although it is, I don't know, a 13 or 14 acre piece, and I'm just estimating. It's sufficiently impinged by wetlands that we could not put the facility on it, even though that was our first choice, because it would be located directly across the street from the junior-senior high school. The other thing is that's important to remember is we live. The school district, meaning all of us, live in a regulatory environment, and that regulatory environment requires, for better or for worse, that school facilities for a high school be placed on a piece of land or on a combination of pieces of land that are of a certain size. And the Landrock Field, even if it was owned by the school district and the Carpenter's property, bearing in mind that only maybe 8 or 9 acres of it is actually usable, do not meet those requirements. That has an impact on the amount of money that we get back from the state of New Hampshire. If we don't meet the requirements, then we run a very significant risk, and in our minds, an unacceptable risk, that we don't get the 30% state aid back from the state of New Hampshire. So we did take a look at the proposal that the gentleman has suggested, and it just didn't work. That was the first thing we looked at. In terms of Landrock Field, the Landrock Field is owned by the town of Newmarket, used by the school district with the cooperation of the town, of course. It is not an adequate facility for our current recreation needs or school needs for that matter. It is significantly in need of repair. And it was originally constructed using federal grant money that constrains any facilities from ever being built there in the future. So the bottom line is we did consider the option the gentleman has proposed, and it just didn't work for us. And that's the long and short of it. Thank you, Bob.
Jonathan.
Jonathan Sheff, 200 South Main Street. I with regard to the amendment before this body, I feel that this article, while I can certainly appreciate the concerns of the individuals who own this land, and I personally would not like to see land taken by eminent domain, I feel that this article should go before the voters. It's vital to our community that a significant body of people have an opportunity to weigh in on this issue, and that it not be, as Chris Hawkins said, effectively zeroed out by this group here tonight. I think that that we should pass this and put it on the ballot and see what the community has to say about this issue, and not constrain the school board in its efforts to try to provide for this community as a whole, as we have empowered them to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Jonathan. I'm gonna elaborate a little bit on what Jonathan said about this body tonight having control. This is the SB2 system of this town. This is what the townsfolk voted for. I'm looking out into an audience, and I do not, in my opinion, see a fair representation of the town at this meeting. This is a voting session. You guys are in control of this meeting and these amendments, these warrant articles, at this time. For those people who are in favor of these warrant articles, they need to do double duty. They not only have to come out next month on the 13th and vote in favor of anything that they wish, they also need to come to this session and speak their opinion to make sure that these warrant articles continue to be written or proposed in a manner that they see fit. So, this is the group we have tonight. You folks are in control. The amendment in front of us is to insert the words "only by written agreement with any selling landowner" into the warrant article. Any further discussion? Seeing none, I'm going to ask for a vote. All those in favor of the amendment to insert the phrase "only by written agreement with any selling landowner" into this warrant article, please raise your hands. Thank you. And those opposed? I see more than 21. Okay. The amendment does not pass. So we're back to warrant article number 3. I'm going to say no. The count is, I counted more than 21, and we had that confirmed by the keepers of the checklist. The amendment does not pass. So we're back to the warrant article number 3 as written before you. Is there any further comment on warrant article number 3? Yes.
If it is, Lynn Badger, if it is the intent of the school board to use these monies only for that land, shouldn't that be spelled out so that the people that are voting on it in the voting booth will have the benefit of all the discussions that we've had here today? I mean, I'd like to know if it said the monies will be used for the plot of land at such and such an address or whatever it is, so they'd know that's what was going to be used for, or even that it will be taken by eminent domain.
Okay, Lynn asked the question about having the specific property in here, and I think I know the answer, but I'm not going to answer it. So would somebody like to comment?
I mean, the cheap and easy way out is to simply say that we're not required by law to specify the property. The answer I'd prefer to give is that the property was recommended to us by the Facilities Committee, has been in the press, has been published, is, I think, very well known to the community. You've heard me say here tonight what our intentions are. So I think the article as written with the understandings that accompany it is fairly stated and accurately stated as it is.
I think I'd like to add, and shoot me down if it's wrong, but there's been no agreement with any landowner, and there's is my microphone not, it's died. I still got a green light.
Try this one. Okay. Just trying to help.
All right, now, does this one, no, that one's on?
Hello?
Okay.
Hello?
Rods works.
There you go, sir.
I'll shut up with Rods.
It must be that independent filmmaker, is his connection to the...
Just need to know which number you're on, so if you don't move...
Okay, so...
Sorry. Number 5 and 11.
So anyway, there's been no written agreement yet, and I think in all fairness to any property owner, it has not been agreed yet. There's still negotiations going on, and there's no decision at this time that would put such a clear statement in the Warren article, but I'll just leave that. Yes, Debbie.
Mr. Moderator, on your handout on the rules, it says a registered voter may challenge any ruling by the moderator, and I would like to challenge that ruling. And additionally, I would also like to request that the count on the amendment be based on secret ballot rather than show of hands.
Okay. Wow, this is fun. Okay. So there was a challenge to my ruling on the vote, and we're going to handle that first. So those in favor of supporting the challenge and moving forward with resurrecting that, please show your hands in favor. This is a vote to overrule the moderator who called on the last vote as overruling. I counted a show of hands that was greater than those opposed to the original vote, and I've been questioned on it. So those who want to overrule me and go back to that amendment, raise your hands, please. I've been, the RSA is put in front of me, but so that we don't lose track here, I'd just like to take a vote now. The number was 28. And those opposed to overruling the moderator. And net, I think, makes 25. Okay. I'm gonna look at this RSA at this time. Questioning a vote. When any vote, other than by ballot, declared by the moderator or other officer presiding, shall immediately and before other business is begun, be questioned in writing or orally by seven or more of the voters present, the moderator or the other official presiding shall retake the vote by secret yes-no ballot.
Just give him this one. Don't fight it. Just give him that one.
Very directional. Okay. One.
So are we at a place where we need seven signatures to go ahead and have a...
Well, by RSA, it says that we should have seven or more voters, and I think by the vote that we took, we have that.
Yes.
All right? So I'm good with that. Really, it should be before other business has begun, and we did move on to the next Warren article. However, please, I see that there's a strong opinion in the audience to go back, and I'm going to go back. And I have here a request per RSA 44 alpha for a secret ballot on this. So what we're going to need to do, and we're prepared for a secret ballot, each registered voter is going to need to come up to the register, the checklist up here, and receive a yes-no ballot form. And I'd like you to hold on to it, and we'll make clear the amendment that's being made, and we'll proceed with business. So I have a question before we start that. Yes, sir.
Question on the article before
No, not on the dollar amount. We're going to be back to the amendment, okay? So please, at this time, we'll just ask everybody to go up to the keepers of the checklist to receive your yes/no ballot.
You get one, okay.
Yes. We need to discuss. I need to make sure everybody's clear on it. That's right. Okay, everybody, please take your seats, please.
Greg.
I think we all want to try to get home at some point tonight.
I'm just going to blame it on you.
Sure. You've got big shoulders with a nice tie.
So you're going to explain to us what this means?
Yes, I will explain. Okay, everybody. So, as you saw, and as was pointed out to me in the rules of the moderator, that I can be overridden, and that is your right, and certainly it was exercised tonight. And I also have a signed request to have a secret ballot cast. So. What you have is a yes/no piece of paper in front of you, and I'm just gonna open up briefly, and it just so it doesn't get carried away. The vote is going to be on an amendment to the warrant to insert the words. Okay, and I'm gonna read this. Okay, after "for the purpose of purchasing land," insert the phrase "only by written agreement with any selling landowner." Now, just real brief, any discussion on the amendment? Thank you. Okay, now before we go forward, I'm going to show you the ballot box. I'm going to set the ballot box up over here. We'll leave it open for a period of time for everybody to cast their vote, and we'll tally the votes in a while. We will return to our seats and go on with the next warrant article while we're still voting on this amendment. We'll come back to it.
He isn't in the box, is it, Bob?
So are we not going to just go?
Just thought I'd check.
We are going to go put them in there.
Yes, certainly.
Greg Thayer from Grant Road. Would you just clarify for everybody what a yes vote means and what a no vote means one more time?
Certainly. Okay, you have a piece of paper in front of you, and it has both a yes and a no on it. Please tear it in half and only put one half in the box. You're laughing, but you know what's going to happen, you know?
It already has.
The half that you're going to put in the box is your opinion on the amendment. If you wish to insert the words only by written agreement with any selling landowner, then please insert a yes in the box. If you wish the warrant article to remain as written, please insert a no. Does anybody have any other questions on how we are going to vote here? Yes, Russ, is it?
Yeah. Do we know how many votes there are in total in the room? Because we didn't really have a process. I know people checked in, but
good question.
Yeah. I hate to think somebody could throw 42 pieces of paper in.
Yeah, we have a tally of all registered voters, and we'll have those votes in total.
Am I correct? A yes vote would preclude the school board from taking the land by eminent domain or using this money to take the land by eminent domain. Is that correct?
I am going to have to disagree with your statement. The yes vote is going to insert in the warrant article only by written agreement with any selling landowner. You're going to have to go to lawyers for that.
Okay. No, thank you.
We have a few here tonight. Jonathan, yes.
What a no vote indicates here is that the voters get to decide this because it goes on the ballot as it is written.
If you insert a no, the warrant article as written on the papers in front of you will stand and will be presented on the ballot next month on the 13th. Okay, I'm gonna leave the ballot box open for a half hour. I'm gonna close it at 9:30. I'm just gonna take 5 minutes right now for people to go put their papers in, come back to your seats, and we're going to go on with business and so forth. Thank you.
Why is the ballot open for a half an hour?
I know.
Just a question, clarification. Everybody's in the room.
Yeah.
Why are you opening the ballot for a half an hour?
I just want to make sure it's
so that means people have to stay here for another hour to find out what the vote is?
Call other people and have them come to the meeting?
All right, I'll take it up with the audience, okay?
That's
two people.
Okay, that's only fair. Russ, I'll take it up with everybody.
We didn't get anybody to turn out.
Okay, John, I should have brought you in the wheelchair.
Really?
Sometimes I get a turnout.
Oh, my wisdom.
It's not a reasonable problem.
Hi.
Okay, everybody, could you get your votes in, please, so we can get on with business? Those people have not yet cast their vote. Please move up to the ballot box so we can continue with business. Okay, may I ask everybody to return to your seats, please? All right, everybody, this is your meeting tonight. If you want to continue, I'd like you all to please be seated. We have a number of folks already seated. I think the majority of us would like to continue. Okay, as a point of call, I have been asked by several people for my reason for leaving the ballot box open for a half hour, and it's been questioned about those people who are already present here in the meeting did so choose to come down and voice their opinion and to get this over with and moved. So I guess just with a yay-nay vote, I'd just like to hear from you folks if you would still like me to leave the ballot box open for a half hour, if you'd like me to close it at this time, because I don't see anybody else waiting to insert any votes. So all those in favor of closing the voting at this time.
That include the new entrants?
All those in favor of closing the voting at this time, please say yay.
Yay. Yay.
Those opposed, say no.
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 I think the yays have it. We will close the ballot box at this time.
In the
Foster, just from Cranberry.
C O N N E R.
Thanks so much.
You can't have it. You can't have a mining California. You can never do their constitution. Not under our constitution.
Oh, big.
You want to change the form of government? That's your problem. But you can't do it. You can't do it through the back.
You got to be clear, transparent.
You live in a representative democracy. When you give your official search authority.
Got to be clear, transparent.
Okay, we've got the votes. We're going to tally those in just a moment. I'd like to we were on what, warrant article number 3, was it?
Yes.
Okay, so we're counting on warrant article number 3. I guess I can't even move to close warrant article number 3 yet. Okay. So, I'm going to postpone the rest of warrant article number 3 and move to warrant article number 4. Okay. Warrant article number 4, to see if the school district will vote to approve the cost item included. May I borrow yours, please?
Oh, certainly.
I ripped the corner off of mine. I'm sorry. Warrant article number 4, to see if the school district will vote to approve the cost item included in the collective bargaining agreement reached between the Newmarket School Board and the Newmarket Teachers Association, which calls for the following increases in salaries and benefits. Year 2007-08, $284,742. Year 2008 to 9, $275,170. 2009 to 2010, $285,120. And further, to raise and appropriate the sum of $284,742 for the 2007-2008 physical year. Each sum represents the additional costs attributable to the increases in salaries and benefits over those of the appropriations at current staffing levels paid in the prior physical year. This is recommended by the school board and budget committee. Majority vote is required. Do I have a motion to put this on the floor tonight?
So moved, Mr. Moderator.
And do I have a second?
I'll second that.
We have a second. Would the school board like to present warrant article number 4?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Moderator. Good evening again. I'm still Chris Hawkins. Linda Montagani was supposed to present this, but unfortunately she's not able to be with us. The teacher contract was negotiated over the course of about 2 months between negotiating teams from the district and the Teachers Association. Newmarket is unique in that we did not require the use of outside negotiators. This was negotiated directly by members of the school board and the school administration and the Teachers Association, which saves everybody some money on lawyers, which I'm personally opposed to, but we were able to achieve some savings by not having to use outside negotiators. The salary increases that you see, we believe, and the tax impact is laid out. No, James, the slide you just had. Thank you. Is laid out there. We think these are worst case numbers. We think that the actual increases will actually be less for a couple of reasons. We have created some incentives in the contract that we are expecting through normal attrition to have some teachers retiring in the next few years. Newer teachers cost less than more experienced teachers. Obviously, you want to maintain a fair balance there. So we believe that these numbers are pessimistic, if that's the right word. These numbers keep our district's teachers slightly below the state average based on the latest statistics that we have available. We do think it's extremely important to compensate teachers fairly in order to make sure that children are educated properly and to meet the other mandates that we have to meet, such as No Child Left Behind.
and otherwise continue to provide good quality education to the children in the district. Something that's not reflected in these numbers, another change that we made, we've been very concerned over the past several years with the increasing cost of health care. You see, you read it in the papers, you see it in your tax bills. We negotiated this year with the teachers that currently teachers in the district get 90% of their health care cost is paid for by the district. We've been very concerned about that because health cost increases are kind of open-ended and we never know where the ceiling is going to be. It obviously goes up at a big number every year. So we've negotiated that new teachers who come into the district will receive 85% of their health insurance costs instead of 90, to try to help the taxpayers get a handle on those costs. We still think that's very competitive with other districts in the area and around the state, but does result in a lowering of the overall contract cost. So that is a very quick overview. There are some other kind of adjustments to things that are done in the contract that are not a significant cost increase, but we think are part of our overall goal of remaining competitive in terms of the quality of education and also making sure that the voters pay no more than is fair and appropriate for teacher salaries and benefits. Thank you. No, that's not mine.
Is this yours?
No. Yours now.
It's a nice pen.
Maybe somebody else has it. Maybe if you hold it up.
Thank you for bearing with me. Okay, warrant article number 4 is teacher's contract in summary. Any discussion on the warrant article as presented tonight? Questions, discussions, concerns? Okay, no amendments this time? Okay, you can't overrule me on this one. Okay, warrant article number 4 I'm going to declare closed. It's going to go on the ballot as presented. Okay, we have tallied the secret votes. For warrant article number 3, for the amendment to insert the words after purpose of purchasing land, the words only by written agreement with any selling land owner. There was 31 votes in favor of the amendment, 34 votes opposed. The amendment does not pass. We are back to warrant article number 3. Again, warrant article number 3, which is to remove funds from capital reserve funds for the expenditure of purchasing land. Is there any further discussion on warrant article number 3 as written? Seeing no further discussion on warrant article number 3, warrant article number 3 is closed and we'll go to the polls as written. Thank you, that was fun. Okay, warrant article number 5.
If by fun you mean terrifying.
If article 4 is defeated, will authorize the school board to call one special meeting at its option to address article 4 cost items only. Recommended by the school board budget committee. The budget committee does not vote on non-budgetary articles. So it was by RSA that they did not have to vote on this, and it was just the committees wanted to make it clear to the public, and they put that wording in there. Is there a motion to present article number 5?
So moved, Mr. Moderator.
Mr. Forrest, thank you. And a second?
Second.
Okay, thank you. All right, does the school board wish to present warrant article 5?
Sure, I'm not going to get up, Bob. You can stay right there. What this article does is simply, if article number 4 fails, it gives us the opportunity to go back to the negotiating table, try to renegotiate the contract, and bring back at a special meeting the single item of a revised teacher contract. This is kind of a safety valve just in case Article 4 fails to pass as currently presented, which God forbid.
Any questions, discussions, concerns on warrant article number 5? Okay, seeing none, I'm going to move that warrant article number 5 will appear on the ballot as written. Moving on to warrant article number 6. To see if the school district will vote to appropriate 2/5, 40% of any June 30th, 2007 fund balance or surplus up to $100,000 to be added to the expansion of school facilities capital reserve fund. This is recommended by the school board and the budget committee, majority of vote next month. Do I have a motion to put this on the floor?
I'll make a motion to put this article on the floor.
Thanks.
And I'll second that.
Okay. And who would like to present warrant article number 6?
Me again?
5 wasn't you.
5 wasn't me?
No.
I'm sorry, I've gone way off the script. This is simply a reiteration of a long-standing warrant article.
Past your bedtime?
Simply a reiteration of a long-standing warrant article that if there is a fund balance at the end of the year, then 40% of it will be allocated to our school facilities capital reserve fund. This has been on the warrant for, I don't know, 15 or 20 years or so. And so it's simply a reiteration of an idea that's been around for a long time to enable us to have some money on hand to address capital reserve needs as they arise without necessarily having to resort to the tax rate to address those needs. Thank you.
Come on right on up. Come on.
Jim Fitzpatrick, just a point of information. How much money, say for the last 3 years at the end of the year, has been appropriated to these funds?
You're asking what is the fund balance at this time?
No. At the end of each fiscal year, how much has been contributed to this fund over the last 3 years?
In each of the last 3 years, $100,000 has been placed into this fund.
So we've had a budget surplus of at least 100 each year.
That is a correct statement.
Thank you.
I should add that most of that has been because of unanticipated revenue. Right. Thank you.
Any other questions, comments, or concerns on warrant article number 6? And no motions. So, seeing no other comments or motions, warrant article number 6 will appear on the ballot as presented. Moving on to warrant article number 7, to see if the school district will vote to appropriate 1/5, 20% of any June 30th, 2007 fund balance or surplus up to $50,000 to be added to the capital reserve fund under the provisions of RSA 35:1-B for the purpose of educating educationally disabled children, recommended by the school board and the budget committee. Do I have a motion to put warrant article number 7 on the floor for discussion?
I'll make that motion, Mr. Moderator.
Thank you. And a second?
I'll second that.
Okay. You guys want to present this?
Mr. Chase will address this, Mr. Moderator.
Thank you.
This is similar in theme as the prior article number 6, except that it is 1/5, 20% of any budget surplus. This and the ones that follow in similar theme actually came from a budget committee suggestions in a couple of years back, and we've adopted them, and they've done great things to, I think, help us prepare for, in this case, unanticipated special education needs. As you know, it's the school district's responsibility to provide education services for all students in the district. And in some cases, there can be an unusual expense to providing some of those services, and having some money, if you will, set aside to deal with unanticipated students that might move into the district, for example, gives us the ability to run a tighter budget, essentially. There's currently just over $100,500 in this fund, and although there's been no formal discussion on where we would stop filling this one, the intent is to cap it about around $200,000, which would be an adequate cushion, if you will. Thanks.
We're on warrant article number 7. Any questions? We're getting thinner here. Okay, I'm going to move on. Warrant article number 7 will appear on the ballot as written. Moving on to warrant article number 8. To see if the school district will vote to appropriate 1/5, 20% of any June 30th, 2007 fund balance surplus up to $50,000 to be added to the expendable trust fund under the provisions of RSA 198:20-C for the purpose of repairs and maintenance of school facilities. Recommended by the school board and the budget committee. Majority vote will be required. Do I have a motion to present this on the floor?
So moved, Mr. Moderator.
Thanks, Cliff. And a second?
I'll second that.
Thanks, Paul. And would you folks like to present?
I'll speak to this one as well. This is essentially a repair and maintenance fund. The things happen in schools as old as our junior senior high school that will be very difficult to deal with unless we have a little bit of money set aside. For example, we have a single boiler system in the high school, in the junior senior high school, and if we need to replace that, we don't want to wait for a budget cycle or put other things in the budget in jeopardy. So similar in theme as the last one, this is an opportunity to set aside 20% of budget surplus. And it's, once again, it's something that the budget committee really feels strongly that is good planning.
Warrant article number 8. Any questions, comments, concerns? Yes, Debbie.
I have a question. A few weeks ago at one of the regular board meetings, Mr. Tremblay did a presentation on the computer equipment, servers, and so on at the school. And as a taxpayer and as a mother of a student who's at the school, I was very concerned because according to him, and I'm sure he knows what he's talking about, the maintenance for the wiring and the AC for the servers, nothing was up to par. And isn't that what this money is supposed to be used for? And is there enough money in the maintenance budget at this time to take care of Mr. Tremblay's concerns so that the computers don't all come crashing down, or that perhaps a building fire occur because the wiring isn't up to par? And I said, I was very concerned. I know we have the maintenance money. I think we need the maintenance money, but I also would like to see that it get used so that the building doesn't get in worse shape. As an owner of an old house, I know that I have to put a lot of money into keeping things up, and I'm hoping that the school district is appropriating this money to do what they're supposed to do also. And I was hoping that someone could address those concerns of Mr. Tremblay's.
Please bear with me. So okay. I just want to summarize your question. So if I read you correctly, you're asking, is it appropriate that funds from this fund be expended for technology equipment?
Well, it's not technology equipment. It's maintenance.
Maintenance
of, as in the wiring. Mr. Tremblay expressed his concerns about the wiring in the building. Right. Wiring, air conditioning, which you need to keep your servers cooled so that
okay.
they run properly.
Okay.
Okay, that was my...
For the infrastructure.
Yes, okay. And my concern was that there is money in hand, and it hasn't been used, and since Mr. Tremblay brought the issue up a few weeks ago, I was just hoping that it could be addressed, and yes, the fund is a good idea.
Certainly. Okay. Would anybody like to answer that question?
I think I can answer that question. We have been, over the last 3 years, spent in excess of $300,000 on repairs and maintenance at the high school. The fund was started, and it was just started. We're only in our second year to, in fact, address some of those concerns. James's concerns around air conditioning and wiring, you can't refute it. We need to continue to address those needs. We have air-conditioned the computer room upstairs. We've also done the same thing in other areas that required air conditioning. James and his staff are on a plan to replace wiring. Last summer, we replaced all of the wiring in the elementary school. So the problem is we just can't do it all at once. Just like a homeowner, you can't do everything at once. So we have been addressing those concerns as they come up. This fund will allow us to continue to do that.
If I may, Mr. Moderator, through this fund process, as a board and working in conjunction with the Budget Committee, we've begun to identify specific projects, for example, bathroom remodels and things like that, which are accessing these reserve funds now, rather than utilize the tax money that is already in possession, as opposed to asking for additional tax money to take care of some of these issues. So while the examples may not necessarily have been the particular air conditioning, you know, the spirit of the question certainly is being addressed as we access these funds to offset larger ticket items so that we don't have to put them directly or ask to be put them directly on the tax rate.
If I may, some of the concerns I have about the building's electricity and air conditioning are best
left.
Those
of you who don't know, this is James Tremblay.
Sorry. They're kind of in limbo with our decision to build or not build another building, because if we do build another building, I would put a new server room in that plan, or ask that we put a new server room in that plan and use fiber optic cabling to wire the existing building to the new building, therefore eliminating any power needs in the older building that I have. Many towns, I know the city of Concord brought all of its elementary schools, its middle schools, into one server room, and total like 75% of their electrical needs in the individual buildings went away. So we don't want to spend good money on a bad project is where I'm at with this whole thing anyways. Thank you.
Thanks, JT.
Anybody else wish to talk on this warrant article? Okay. Seeing none, then I'm going to close warrant article number 8. It will appear on the ballot as currently written. Moving on to warrant article number 9.
Mr. Moderator, before you move on to warrant article number 9, can I make a motion to not reconsider any previous warrant articles that have been closed? We have had in the past at some of these meetings a tendency to go back and reopen things after a number of people have left. And I'm hoping that we can make a motion to not do that and just consider the remaining articles rather than reopen previous articles.
Okay, if I may help you, the motion you will make is to limit reconsideration on all previous warrant articles as discussed.
That's correct.
And I think I see a second in the back of the room.
There's one here.
Okay.
It's Greg Thayer.
Okay.
Greg Thayer.
Sorry. Greg Thayer.
Jonathan
Sheff, and seconded by Greg Thayer. Okay, let me just explain to everybody who might not be fully aware of the motion at hand. You, the voters here tonight, are being asked to limit reconsideration on all previous warrant articles, and that means that we will not reopen any previous discussions that we've already had tonight. If somebody does so choose to open any previous discussions, you do have the right to do so. However, they will be discussed at another town meeting, a special town meeting that the town will have to pay for, because we will have to post it, make notices, and hold a special town meeting to take up the discussion on any previously discussed warrants if somebody does request to do that tonight. So, does anybody have any questions on the motion that's on the floor? I'm going to take a vote right now. Those in favor of limiting reconsideration, please raise your hands. About 23. And those opposed, please raise your hands. I think the motion does pass. So we will not, the motion passes to limit reconsideration on all previous discussions tonight. Okay, moving on to warrant article number 9. To see if the school district will vote to appropriate 1/5, 20% of any June 30th, 2007 fund balance or surplus up to $50,000 to be added to the expendable trust fund under the provisions of RSA 198:20C for the purpose of purchasing technology equipment. Equipment includes replacing computers at the junior senior high school and at the elementary school, printers and additional equipment, software for classrooms and administrative use. Recommended by the school board and the budget committee, majority vote will be required. Do I have a motion to put warrant article number 9 on the floor for discussion?
So moved, Mr. Auditor.
And a second?
Second.
I'm going to take
James
a second
Trumbly.
From
James Trumbly for the second.
He'll probably third it also, if necessary.
Yeah.
Okay, would the school board like to present this?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Moderator. Very briefly, I'm going to stay in my chair. This is another budget committee initiated concept that came forward a couple of years ago. As Mr. Chase has explained, it's basically allowing us to meet fundamental technology needs, replacing obsolete equipment, replacing obsolete software, doing upgrades without having to resort to the tax base to do it. The underlying theory and assumption is that there's certain things like maintenance and special ed and technology needs that the voters simply want us to deal with without having to resort to the tax base for everything. And so this gives us the opportunity and flexibility to do that. We have a State Department of Education approved technology plan, and we use this money to help fund the implementation of that plan, because of course in the modern world technology is extremely important, and we want to make sure that we give our children access to adequate equipment and software for their benefit now and in the future. Thank you, Bob.
Thanks, Chris. Any questions, comments, concerns? Yes, sir.
Todd Roger, what does it take to get money out of these reserve funds? Who has to approve expenditures out of these reserve funds?
When the funds were initially created, the school board was set up as agents of the funds, so we can authorize expenditures out of them. We typically do that in consultation with the budget committee so that we're all kind of on the same page.
But it does not require approval of the budget committee?
Expenditure of the funds, I don't think, requires approval of the budget committee, but we like to keep in touch.
I just think it would be helpful to have a little more transparency here and to have maybe some history of what's gone into these funds and what's come out of these funds.
Sure.
And you don't have to do it now, but I think in general, that would be very helpful.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
And I guess to answer your question is those balances and input-output is available at the SAU offices on the third floor during regular business hours. Feel free to stop by to have your question answered.
I don't think we've expended any money out of this fund at this point, and there's currently $50,500 in it.
There are currently plans, as we discussed with the Budget Committee at one of the Saturday morning meetings. I believe you were at that meeting, to specifically spend some of this funds to meet a current technology need, to bring again some of that money out of the regular budget so that we're not increasing the tax rate. So there is a plan in place right now to do some of the fiber optics, if I remember correctly, out of this fund.
Were we also looking at whiteboards too? Was that some of the
smart board?
Smart boards, yes,
smart
correct.
Boards. They were white in color.
Yes, they were.
Okay. So, so thank you.
Anybody wish to ask any further questions? Make any amendments? We're going to move on then. Warrant article number 9 will appear on the ballot as written. I'm going to move on to warrant article number 10. To see if the school district will raise and appropriate as an operating budget, including appropriations by special warrant articles and other appropriations voted separately, the amounts set forth on the budget posted with the warrant or as amended by the vote of the first session tonight for the purposes set forth herein totaling $13,134,525. Should this article be defeated, the default budget shall be $12,950,889, which is the same as last year with certain adjustments required by previous actions of the Newmarket School District or by law, or the school board may hold one special meeting in accordance with RSA 40:13-10 and 16 to take up the issue of revised operating budget only. Recommended by the school board and the budget committee. Majority vote next month. Note, this warrant article, the operating budget, does not include appropriations of any other warrant articles previously discussed tonight. So do I have a motion to present warrant article number 10 on the floor tonight?
So moved, Mr. Moderator.
Thank you. And a second?
Second.
Thank you, Forrest. And would the school board like to present this?
Sure.
Cliff?
I'll just highlight a few of the high points, and we can address specifics as necessary. The overall increase is $275,798, which is 2.1% budget increase, which is 16 cents per thousand, as reflected on the tax rate. Some of the items include $7,500 supporting the mentor program, which is my understanding has been very successful. $5,000 to support Channel 13. Increase the town obligations for the state's retirement benefits. Those don't go down. Improved curriculum materials. There's a new curriculum, everyday math, that's been being rolled out, and currently there's movement towards making some changes in language arts, which require new materials. 4% increase in the pay rate for non-union employees. The article we spoke about earlier, the teacher's contract, does not include many that work in the school district, and this is to try to compensate them as well. 15% increase in healthcare benefits. No surprise for anyone that those don't go down as well. Two new paraprofessional positions. Those are what is known as often as one-on-one aides in some cases. $6,000 to support drug and alcohol counselor. Increases in oil utilities and electrical costs. That's what we anticipate. That's, as you know, very hard to try to guess, especially considering this is the this is the budget year 2007-2008, so it's not like we're planning for the immediate future in that. It's very tricky. There's miscellaneous things that aren't addressed by some of the things that were highlighted earlier with the reserve fund. The differences between the requested funds and the default budget is $183,636, which is a 26 cents difference in the tax rate. This is received unanimous approval by the budget committee, and any questions, we can take it from there.
Okay, warrant article number 10 is the operating budget for the next fiscal year. Any questions, comments, or concerns on the warrant article as presented? Okay. Seeing none, warrant article number 10 will remain on the be on the ballot next month as written. We do have one further warrant article, number 11, and please remain seated for just a few more moments to conduct any other actions at this time, any other business at this time. And I see none. So I'd like to entertain a motion to adjourn.
So move, Mr. Moderator.
And a second. Second from James. Okay. This meeting is closed. Thank you.